Welcome to the third session in the webinar series, Applying Best Practices to Diverse Older Adults, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and the Natividad Medical Center. My name is Christopher Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on Behavioral Activation and Effective Intervention for Late Life Depression. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write them. The presenters will respond to your questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. And now I would like to introduce the director of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center and professor of Research Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Stanford University School of Medicine, Dr. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson.
Welcome to this webinar. We're delighted to have the opportunity to talk to you and to share our experience regarding behavioral activation with adults, older adults, and ethically diverse adults. We're going to start by talking about the theoretical background of behavioral activation, just briefly, so that everyone is on the same page starting out. Then we'll review the evidence base for it and its use with ethnic minority or diverse clients. We will go in great detail into the steps in the actual process. We will discuss case examples, and we will have some time for questions and discussion at the end. You should see this slide on your screen now, which is the outline of what the webinar will cover. I also want to mention that we are developing a skill training experiential program on behavioral activation so that individuals who want to learn more about the hands-on work and actually have an opportunity to interact with us more about that will have that opportunity in the future. More about that to come later. Right now, though, I would like to introduce my friend and colleague, Dr. Kim Bullock, who will start us out. Dr. Bullock is a psychiatrist and clinical associate professor in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences here at Stanford. She sees a wide variety of patients in the behavior medicine and neuropsychiatry clinics, and she specializes in the application of cognitive behavior therapy to somatoform disorders. Kim teaches and supervises medical students, graduate students, and psychiatry residents on how to implement CBT. She is also a training consultant for the National Veterans Administration Cognitive Behavior Therapy Dissemination Project. So, Kim, can you tell us a little bit about what is CBT?
Yes, thank you. CBT is a form of psychotherapy that was actually developed by a psychiatrist called the CBT approach, and how they can feel less depressed by changing their negative thinking patterns as well as changing their behaviors and their emotional responses. So CBT is an evidence-based program. It's been found to be effective in randomized controlled trials in over 400 outcome studies for numerous disorders, including depression, anxiety disorders, substance abuse, and depression. And depression associated with common medical problems, especially relevant for that elderly, irritable bowel syndrome, chronic fatigue, hypertension, fibromyalgia, cancer, diabetes, and chronic pain disorders. And here's a kind of simplified model of Beck's CBT therapy. And it does focus on thoughts, although as you can see, the interaction between behaviors, emotions, and physical well-being is involved in the model. But there is primarily a focus on thoughts, how they are related, influence behaviors, and also you can see the arrows are going back and forth, how behaviors influence thoughts.
The same with emotions, how thoughts influence emotions, emotions influence thoughts, and how all of these different aspects affect physical well-being. So what emerged from this model was a factor analysis of a component analysis of some parts of CBT that were especially effective for depression. And a researcher named Lewinson developed a model that actually really just focused on the behavioral end of CBT, and it was found to be very effective. And there were two patterns that emerged that were commonly associated with depression. First, a low rate of response contingent positive reinforcement, especially from others. So in other words, depressed individuals do not get enough pleasure from their interactions with the environment and with other people. And then the second part is that high rates of punishment occur in their environments. Depressed individuals may have excessive or persistent involvement with aversive or noxious events or people. So basically, as far as the reasons for these low rates of positive reinforcement, especially in the elderly, would be often adults lack social skills needed to engage in positive interactions with others, or have lost some social skills, or find themselves in a different cultural situation than their skills allow for. And so obtaining positive feedback from others may be more challenging. They may be overly passive or overly aggressive in interpersonal situations. And then the second, the potency of former positive reinforcers may be diminished somewhat. Things that used to bring them pleasure no longer do. This is very common complaint of older adults. So high rates of punishing experiences. How does this happen? So depressive feelings are reinforced when there are many punishers in the environment, such as people who are aversive to be around, environmental stress, negative situations that can't be changed, chronic health problems, multiple losses. Also, older adults clients may lack, as a result of having the lack of social skills needed to cope with negative events, people or experiences that reoccur, such as longstanding stress with adult children and years of conflict in these relationships. Such clients often feel that they are unable to modify the environment, in this case, improve their interpersonal relationships with family and members. And this may be crucial to maintaining their depression or depressive symptoms. So the simplified version of Lewinson's model is that there's a lack of active engagement in the environment, a lack of pleasure, which causes depressive symptoms. And these depressive symptoms feed back and cause more lack of active engagement in the environment. And what you have is a positive feedback cycle. So simply put, behavioral activation helps depressed people improve their mood by learning skills to help them change their everyday behaviors and institute new patterns. By doing this, patterns of avoidance, withdrawal, and inactivity are challenged and changed. This helps to reduce feelings of depression at any age. So the goal of behavioral activation is to learn specific skills to increase engagement in the everyday positive activities. This in turn will lead to more positive reinforcement for the client and less depression. Behavioral activation may also impact clients' negative thinking processes, since now they are doing more than they thought they could, and that in turn may improve their sense of well-being, as suggested in the CBT model. So the treatment rationale is that we want to increase healthy behaviors, decrease depressed behaviors, so that more positive experiences are included, and this will then in turn improve thoughts and mood. So now I'll hand it over back to Dr. Gallagher-Thompson.
Thank you, Kim. I'd like to now go into more about the evidence base. Okay, so we've heard a little bit about what is behavioral activation and why theoretically it makes sense to do with people who are depressed, but have there been studies on it? And the answer is yes. There are many studies in the literature that show that behavioral activation works. It works well with a variety of clients, and including ethnically diverse clients. The robust effects have been found in reviews of the literature, the most recent being Dimidgin's in 2011. An example would be with younger clients, however, is that behavioral activation was found to be more effective than cognitive therapy and equivalent to medication for treating depression. A treatment manual for a brief form of behavioral activation exists and is available in the reference from Lejeune, Hopko, and Hopko. Research with older adults found similar results. A good deal of it was conducted by colleagues and myself in California and in other states. We also have treatment manuals available upon request. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about how you might modify behavioral activation to make it work with diverse clients. In this case, we're going to talk first about Hispanic or Latino clients. So there is an adapted version of behavioral activation called BAL, which is available in Spanish and in manual form. In fact, there's more than one version. Most of the research has been conducted by Munoz and his associates at UCSF and Cantor and his group in another state. And these are the two individuals from whom you can obtain these manuals in Spanish. I believe they're available at no cost. One of the most recent studies done by Cantor in 2010, predominantly women mean age of 40, seen for an average of 12 sessions, reported a very significant clinical drop of about 50% in depression scores on both the Beck Depression Inventory and the Hamilton Rating Scale for Depression, which are two clinical measures that are used frequently in outpatient mental health settings. So this most recent study again supports the efficacy of this approach with Latino clients. Now, I think it's important to ask, why does behavioral activation work with Latino clients so that we can have ideas about how to use it in our own practice? So one thing that's important to emphasize is that behavioral activation be presented as an educational learning tool. This fosters empowerment and treatment engagement. It also enables the therapist to be seen as a teacher and helper and a guide. Behavioral activation Latino version pays attention to cultural values and how they might influence the activation process. It is challenging to activate a client who does not wish to confront her husband about his aggressive behavior towards her, yet she wants to get out of the house and be able to do more on her own. It's very challenging to do that while respecting the cultural values of Marianismo and Machismo. Another example, activating a client who wants to go to church but feels she is being followed by a presencia negative. These situations require some knowledge of the culture and how to work with it so that you're able to really do behavioral activation appropriately. Another suggestion is to recommend free or low-cost and culturally sensitive activities. To suggest these if the client has difficulty thinking of them on their own, like attending local festivals that celebrate the culture, going to the park with family. Many of these are also going to be consistent with the Latino cultural value of familismo. And just a little more on that, it's recommended that in early sessions, basic information about depression is given to the client and the family. We discovered that there are a number of free handouts translated into various languages, including Spanish, published online by the Academy of Family Medicine that contain this type of information and could be useful to you in your practice. And explaining behavioral activation is usually done by explaining that a key to treating depression is to overcome avoidance and passivity. That what we need to do is take action to solve problems and schedule things that bring meaning and pleasure to one's life, which is very similar to what Dr. Bullock mentioned in her slides. I'm just emphasizing that the same points have been found to be effective or to add to the effectiveness of behavioral activation with Latino clients. Now, with Chinese clients, we find also that there have been a number of studies done to show that behavioral activation and CBT, more generally, has been effective to treat depression and self-esteem issues. With a few modifications, it does appear to be a viable form of therapy. So once again, it seems to me we'd be interested in why does it work with Chinese and Chinese American individuals. Well, one point that's been brought out in the literature is that there are many parallels between Chinese cultural values and norms and the philosophy as well as implementation of CBT. And we suggest the Chen and Davenport paper for more information on this. But just briefly, I want to mention that the last point, number three there, Chinese American clients often have lower tolerance for ambiguity. This relates to the hierarchical structure of Chinese society, where roles are clearly defined according to one's gender and place in the family. So because of this history of being in a hierarchical society with fairly stringent role definitions, Chinese American clients tend to prefer structure and practical immediate solutions to their problems. And additional research has suggested that they prefer therapists who apply a directive rather than a non-directive approach, which certainly would be consistent with behavioral activation. And here are just, again, a few suggested modifications to when working with Chinese clients. The first one is similar to what we mentioned about Latino individuals, namely the importance of educating the client so that they will have an understanding of depression and more realistic expectations about what is going to happen. This is consistent with the cultural value of respect for authority and the norm that hard work will lead to a better life. Also similar to what was mentioned for Latinos, often some type of assertiveness training will be necessary, helping the individual to express themselves in some situations at least, particularly situations where there's considerable interpersonal conflict. It's important to remember as well that depression among Chinese Americans may be presented in terms of somatic complaint rather than typical psychological symptoms. So the therapist needs to acknowledge that and needs to explain to the client that their sense of physical well-being may actually improve after their mood improves. And finally, we want to be aware of and respect the cultural values of collectivism and interpersonal harmony. So in this case, behavioral activation might involve developing a list of shared positive activities that family members can do together. It may also involve learning skills so that positive reinforcement can be obtained outside the family if that will reinforce harmony within the family. Now, I'd like to draw your attention to a specific program that was conducted with ethnic minority older adults, which is called the IDEAS program, Identifying Depression Empowering Activities for Seniors. This is a community-based program. It incorporates four evidence-based components, and it is delivered within a care management orientation. Screening and assessment, education, referral and linkages to appropriate additional resources, and behavioral activation, a key component of this program. So an evaluation reported by Kahano and Associates in 2007 was done with approximately 100 low-income, predominantly Hispanic and African-American women, a mean age of 72, with no cognitive impairment. They found that another commonly used scale to assess depressive symptoms, the geriatric depression scale, showed a significant reduction over time. Beyond that, though, the clients reported that the increased activities helped them feel better. They actually saw that relationship. And they also reported that they experienced less pain and had increased knowledge of how to get additional help. So it appeared that the behavioral, that the entire program, the IDEAS program, was able to make significant changes in their quality of life. It's also, I think, very valuable for you to know that there exists an intervention manual for this program and technical assistance at the website shown here on the slide. As of May 2010, more than 30 agencies in 15 states had adopted and implemented this program. So in conclusion, I'd like to say that there is a strong evidence base for the efficacy of behavioral activation to reduce depression in adults, older adults, and ethnically diverse older adults. And now I'd like to turn this back to my colleague, Dr. Bullock, who's going to discuss with you the steps in the behavioral activation process.
Thank you. Yes, now we're going to get to the nuts and bolts and the actual skills, the simplified version of behavioral activation here, so you can feel like you walk away with some skills. And I'll just review the three-step model of behavioral activation. So the first step is activity monitoring, step one. So at this step, we assess how the client's spending their time with an activity log that we'll review after this slide. And also, it's a chance to see what positive activities could be added into their days to boost the mood. Step two is activity scheduling. At this point, that's a chance to actually change and get more positive activities scheduled in, tracking progress, and actually making some modifications is step three, where the list and changes are modified based on feedback, based on barriers and culture, and then committing to scheduling new activities and then to reinforcing these changes using an activity schedule log. And again, the continuing of tracking and doing things for as long as necessary is important to keep in mind. So self-reports are not as accurate as logs of activities kept for a week between sessions. Depressed persons tend to underreport positive experiences, emphasize negative perceptions, and focus more on failures than successes. So it's important to get people to do this between sessions. The weekly activity log is a form that's typically assigned as homework, but should be started in session to ensure that the patient understands the concept and knows what is expected. So here's the basic activity log. You have clients write in each box their activity and a mood rating from 0 to 10. And this is an example of the morning until 3 o'clock. There's a continuation page in which you can do more hours. And how you started in session is first have the client bring a form out and ask them to fill out his or her activities for each time block before the treatment session and then beginning with the day of therapy. If you have time in the therapy session and you can go to the prior day, do that. But the important part is to actually go through step by step and model how to fill out the log with the patient. Then, two is encourage the client to write in activities that actually occurred, no matter how mundane, bathing, dressing, eating, traveling, talking with others, watching TV, and sleeping. Sometimes people underestimate the amount of pleasure that even simple things can represent. So it's important to have a client write down in as much detail as possible. Step three, ask them to rate on a simple scale from 1 to 10, the degree of enjoyment or a sense of mastery, accomplishment, or pleasure. So you can use words, you can use terms that that you can modify depending on the client and cultural sensitivity. So it is flexible in that manner, but we're really looking for enjoyment and mastery. Sometimes mastery and accomplishment are equivalent to pleasure and enjoyment. So we want to understand which activities are associated with positive mood. So number four, some simple tasks might receive high ratings for mastery. Clients should try to give themselves credit for small accomplishments because progress is generally made in small incremental steps. Five, low ratings of pleasure should be expected for two reasons. If there's a little involvement in activities that most people would consider highly pleasurable, or if the capacity for experiencing joy or pleasure is blunted. So encourage the client to at least give a rating of 1 to 3 if minimal pleasant feelings are experienced. So here are some questions to stimulate thinking while they're filling out the monitor, the activity log and monitoring their activities. So first, are there specific periods of time when the person experiences enjoyment or pleasure? What kinds of activities seem to give the person pleasure? Can these pleasurable activities be repeated on another day? What activities appear to give the person a sense of accomplishment? Can these types of activities be scheduled for other days? Are there certain times of day that appear to be low on mastery or pleasure? What can be done to improve activity patterns during those times of day? Do the ratings tend to be higher for activities that involve other people? If so, can social contact be increased? What activities did the patient do in the past that have been stopped or reduced? Are there opportunities for rekindling interest in these or similar activities? And are there any types of activities, exercise, music, spiritual involvement, arts, crafts, reading, volunteer work, cooking, that the patient is ignoring but that may be of interest? Is he or she open to considering adding new or different activities to the weekly schedule? So here's an example client. Who started doing the activity log and monitoring their activities. And as you can see, it was not done perfectly, which is perfectly normal. There were some days missing and some times missing, but they did a pretty good job. And you can see there's a variety of ratings of mood. And again, this person wasn't terribly depressed. But you can see there's some kind of a range from 3 to 9. And so when you're looking at the activity log with the client, it's important to look for some patterns. So in this client, you can see how doing something like an art class at Moss Landing on day 5, between 9 and 10, you can see she rated that a 9. So there's something about being involved in the creative activity that gave her a lot of pleasure. And then the other 9 occurs on day 7, between 9 and 10, made a healthy breakfast for herself and a neighbor. So maybe something altruistic or being with other people. Her low rating seems to be when she's alone or not doing anything very productive. So these are kinds of things you want to discuss with the client on an individualized basis and see if there's any patterns or any take-home messages. So this was the just continuations of the log. This was from 12 noon to 11 p.m., so similar ratings. So step 2, after the initial monitoring of the current activities is done, it's necessary to identify activities that in the past gave the client a sense of pleasure or mastery that they may not be doing now. And again, it's very individualized. Also, it's necessary to discuss any barriers to doing any of the things either that are currently pleasant or in the past were pleasant or that you're wanting to plan or add that may be pleasant, and to problem solve with the clients. They can plans can be made on how to implement them. So the important part is that the client sees the relationship between activities and mood, and then after that association is made, then the behavior chain of change of increasing those activities that are likely to have the most positive impact on mood. So how do we do this? So first, generating a list of pleasurable activities can be very helpful. Include the ones from the monitoring exercise that had high scores and that had the highest rating for pleasure. Also, you can brainstorm with a patient a list of some new ideas that may be worth trying. And again, think about from their past, a time when they were happier, what kinds of activities were going on. So it's a collaborative effort to determine which activities to add to the person's daily routine. So select specific times and write them on the schedule as a plan for the following week. So again, scheduling will make it more likely. So here's an example of the tracking form. Here, pleasant events and monitoring your mood are done by generating in the session with the clients some possible events, maybe using the monitoring log from step one, and also thinking about some past activities. There's also lists that you can find of adults' pleasant activities in case a person can't think of something that might be pleasant to do. And here's an example of someone who completed one. So you can see that this is this is the same client, and you can see how on some days there were not any pleasant activities, and there was a range in the number of pleasant activities on each day. So on the bottom, there's a total, and here they can see the number of pleasant activities that were engaged in, and also their mood score. And in general, for most people, although it's not universal, that the increase in number of pleasant activities usually will correspond with an increase in mood. And this was the case in this client. As you can see, on the days that there were three or less, the mood was lower than the days when there were more pleasant activities. So you want to have the patient, again, see that connection. Then it does require some creativity, as this slide illustrates, to change behavior. And step three is about modification. So this is based on some of what you find in step one and step two and some of the barriers that are identified. So modifying the scheduling based on feedback barriers, cultural considerations is very important. And what was successful for the person, what activities actually improved their mood, is a key question. So common obstacles with older adults are, I don't feel well enough to do anything, I'm too tired. A lot of times there's no one left of my old friends to do the activities that were previously pleasurable. These negative thinking patterns need to be addressed before the person can really engage in behavioral activation. So this may need to be investigated. So some older depressed persons don't seem to want to increase their activities and often believe there's nothing left that will bring them any enjoyment. This means that behavioral activation will be challenging but not impossible. You'll have to start small and go slow in order to see change. I kind of think of it as sometimes it's just water over rock, and you have to just be patient and go very slowly. So here's an example of the same client who modified her pleasant activities and decided to actually include on every day, you can see on this one, pleasant activities, and then got her mood ratings above 5 on every day, and also picked out some of the most potent pleasurable activities. So both increasing the frequency of the pleasant activities as well as the potency of the activities seem to increase her mood. And here we actually have the evidence base from the Beck Depression Index, which is a validated and standardized measure of depression. You can see this person was moderately to mildly depressed before starting behavioral activation, and by session 10 or 11 was into the normal range. So now I'd like to go back to Dr. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson, and she will discuss some of her cases using behavioral activation.
Thank you, Kim. This case I'd like to share with you is the case of Mr. A. We're going to, in reviewing this case, we're going to review a lot of the points that Dr. Bullock just made, and because we think that repetition will help learning and will be a way to perhaps reinforce some of these ideas in your mind and also give you an opportunity to see how it works with a male client. The case that she presented was a female client. So this one He's 72 years old, a widowed Latino gentleman. He's part Native American, has three adult children and numerous grandchildren who live nearby. He's bilingual in Spanish and English. He went to high school, worked in construction and landscaping for most of his life, and now works part-time as a musician in his church. So he has a number of talents, and he had been a very hard worker, very engaged in his family all of his life, according to his report. He does have significant medical comorbidities, including severe arthritis, type 2 diabetes that he has difficulty keeping under good control, and he has a history of heart disease. So because of these problems, he's had to significantly reduce the type of activities that he can engage in. He also has a very low income at the present time. He reports his income to be below $20,000, and this can be challenging for finding activities for people to engage in, you know, depending if they're used to having a higher income level and then all of a sudden they're down at that level, then the type of activities that they're going to be able to add to their list and to find, you know, to really practice in their everyday lives might be somewhat more limited. Okay, so here we find his activity log. This is the gentleman in his, this is his own handwriting. This is not doctored or changed in any way. And call your attention to the fact that, first of all, it is not completely filled out, similar to the case that Dr. Bullock presented. You see a lot of gaps in there, and you can also see that there are a variety of activities and a variety of mood ratings. So what do we want to learn from this? This is our step one, remember. We're having them complete the activity log, starting it in the meeting that you have with them, and then giving it to them for homework or home practice to return at the next meeting, if possible. That would be the way that you would want to structure it. So what do we want to look at? I want to call your attention first to the thing that had the lowest rating for pleasure or enjoyment, which was talking to his sister. He rated that as a 1. And then above that, you see that the highest, the thing that brought him the most pleasure, was making love to his girlfriend, which he rated as a 10. And between the 1 and the 10, there's a great deal of variety. So we see if we look over the first day, 1 to 2 p.m., he went to aqua therapy, and he rated that a 5. So on our 1 to 10 rating scale, the 5 is in the middle. So that's the so-so rating. You know, it wasn't bad. It wasn't particularly good. Underneath that, we have another 5, picking up his friend at the airport. Then we also have over here on day 4 another 5 for an apple class. What this means is that we happen to be in an area where there's a lot of classes offered by adult schools, and this indicates this man's interest, you know, in continual self-improvement, that he had been signed up to take a class, a computer class, in an adult learning environment offered in his area. And the type of computer that he used was an Apple computer, so he calls it an Apple class. So that's what that refers to. And also want to call your attention above that, worked on video on day 4. He also worked on video on day 2. And he gives the video rating a 5 as well, if you can see that. So now let's look at day 1, where he's got a 3 from 8 to 9 a.m., so that's where he must have woken up and tried getting himself ready for the day, and then a 4 for eating breakfast, a 4 for going to his therapy appointment. Okay, so that wasn't very enjoyable for him. And then you see another 1, mulling, and I want to explain what he meant by that. Mulling is his term for worrying, so he mulls things over in his mind. You know, this would be the cognitive piece that we might get to, depending how much this bothers him, but obviously it was not enjoyable. He only reported it in 1 time slot, but we don't really know how often it occurred because the form is not really complete. So what do we do now? Well, if we remember what Dr. Bullock said earlier, the next thing we would do is we would ask some questions, right? We would ask, what else could he do that would be enjoyable, that he could add in to his activities? For example, could he make love to his girlfriend more often? That's a possibility, maybe not a probability, we don't know, but we could certainly explore that. We could ask him more about the things that he rated only a 5. How could they possibly become more enjoyable? So if you notice, a couple of them involve classes, right? The computer class, the Apple class, and then the water, the aqua therapy. That's a class, like a water aerobics class, in a warm pool. So these are situations that involve other people. Perhaps they could be made more enjoyable for him if he were to speak to people in those two environments. So that would be another type of question to explore with him. How could we possibly increase the enjoyability of those activities? So here's what we came up with as the next step in the process, where we're asking him to write down on the left-hand side pleasant events, down that column, making a list of activities based upon what we got from the log and based upon the questions that we asked him. What would he like to put down that he could track, meaning keep a record of during the subsequent week before he comes back for the next appointment? And he, many of them came directly from the log. The aqua therapy, item number 2. Number 4, classes at Apple, the Apple classes. Number 9, working. What he means by working there is working on the video. Okay, so he kept those, but you also see some new ones were added. Okay, laughter was added, the first one. The third one, playing music, relates to his activities at the church, but he added that. He added hanging with his son, time with one of his adult sons, walking on the beach. He happens to live in a community that's near a beach. Great time with his grandkids, and visualizing Hawaii, which was something very pleasurable to him as a possibility, at least, something that he might enjoy doing in the future, actually going there. Now, I'd like to also call your attention. So we have the list. Now, you don't always get 10 items. We have a space for 10. Sometimes you only get 2 or 3. The more depressed the person is, the fewer the items, generally speaking. But I'd say to aim for 5 to 6, that mid-range, at least try to get that the first pass through. And then notice on the days of the week, what he's entered there is the mood rating, how enjoyable, how this made him feel when he did these particular things. So the next thing we look at is what actually happened. So what actually happened? Well, he was able to laugh every day, it looks like, and he enjoyed it. Almost every day he went to his aqua therapy. These are high ratings. Remember, it's a 1 to 10 scale. He enjoyed that. If we go down the list to number 9, working on the video, we see that that's virtually every day, and most of the time it's rated high. Visualizing Hawaii, rated high. So some of these items, therefore, what this tells me is some of these are worth continuing on the next tracking sheet, because he's going to be doing this probably for a month, at least a month. A month is recommended. So some of these items we're going to continue over. Now look at the ones that didn't happen. He writes in NA for the ones that didn't happen. So the only one that didn't happen at all was hanging with his son. So that's an item for discussion. And then you'll notice item number 5 was changed from the more amorous version to peaceful time with his girlfriend. And that only happened a few times in that particular week. He still obviously wants to keep up a relationship with his girlfriend, so that needs to stay on his list. So in looking at this list, I'm also struck by the fact that on item number 7, walking on the beach, and item number 8, time with the grandkids, we have a few 9s in there. So even though, this is, I think, an important point when you're looking at these and you're trying to interpret these forms, even though they didn't occur often, those particular things were very pleasurable when they did occur. So this leads to another point that Dr. Bullock made, which is try to discover what the obstacles were. You know, how come he didn't spend more time with his grandkids, particularly given that it was so enjoyable? Are there ways he could increase that frequency? Could he walk on the beach more often? In discussing this point about hanging out with his son, spending time with his son, we discovered that that was one that actually was not going to be continued, because there was a lot of tension there in the relationship with the son, and that actually led in a different direction, not in the behavioral activation direction. So let's look at this one. Now, this is a follow-up tracking form, and you can see that some of the items are the same. The second one, I know this is a little harder to read, but it still says aqua therapy. The third one says play music. He kept that. He kept classes, Apple, the computer classes. He kept peaceful times with girlfriend. The next one is new, watching baseball. Okay, that's one that he added. As we went along, we discovered that even though he can't play the sport anymore and he used to be active, he does enjoy watching it. Aqua therapy, I should have mentioned that when we were going through that. Item number two, he increased the frequency. He discovered that he can go to different centers in his area that have specialized classes for specialized water classes for people with severe arthritis. And so that was something that he was able to look, you know, ferret out on his own and increase on his own initiative. If you go back to the list, number seven, walking on the beach is still there. Number eight is spending time with the grandchildren. That's still there. Though, again, if you look across, it only happened on Saturday. It only happened once. And the last item, the next item, shopping for Halloween, number nine, that's new. Number 10 is the same, working on the video. So you can see that he has added some new things. He has refined some of the things on the list. And he is tracking very, conscientiously. I would like to call your attention, though, to the mood score down on that last set, going across that last row. You see that he still has no overall mood rating. The numbers above are the total number of activities for the day. But we have some other information that tells us that the behavioral activation was working, and that is that his Beck Depression Inventory scale for that particular session when this was reviewed was only a 7, which is low, and it indicates an improvement in his depression. So let's summarize a bit here. What did we learn from this particular record being completed? We learned a lot more about this gentleman. We learned that most days he's pretty active, and that he's got the concept. I think this is what I would emphasize that you look for when you're working with people on behavioral activation is, do they really understand the relationship between activity and mood? Do they get it? Because if they get it and they're able to implement it, as this person was, then we know that behavioral activation is something that they're going to continue, that it's not just going to stop when the sessions end. And this is another graphic depiction of how his Beck Depression Inventory changed over time in the course of 12 different meetings, how it got down to a non-depressed range. So behavioral activation clearly was something that was effective for him and something that he was able to implement. So in summary, 3 steps. Activity monitoring, how does the client spend their time now? What things can be added in to boost their mood? You try to get them to schedule these things in and track them on a tracking form. The form we are showing you is one that we use in our work, but you're free to develop your own version of it, and then you modify based upon their actual experience and their feedback. And I'd like to just give you this takeaway message, which is something that we've discovered or really teach our trainees, in working with older adults, is that the magic number, how many things they seem to need to do every day in order to maintain a positive mood, is 4 pleasant activities. So that's our little mantra. 4 pleasant activities a day keeps the blues away. And the case that Dr. Bullock presented, and in this one, if you go back on the slides, you'll see that virtually every day he had at least 4. One day he had only 3. And in hers, the same thing, if you check back, you'll see. The activities have to be consciously chosen and deliberately done. And the concept, again, is events or activities can have an influence on mood. To some extent, you can control them, activities and your events in your daily life. Therefore, to some extent, you can control your mood. So by increasing the sense of control, you increase your sense of efficacy or mastering for reducing depression and improving your own quality of life. So with this, I'd like to open it up for questions, discussion, clarification. We see nothing on the chat screen at the moment, so I'm not exactly sure if people were just didn't have any questions as we went along, or if you just need some time, you know, a moment or so to reflect on what was said, and then perhaps you'll share with us some questions or comments. If you don't have questions or need for clarification at this time, if you have any comments, we would be very happy to know about them.
Thank you, Drs. Gallagher-Thompson and Bullock.
Are there any questions?
There's no questions yet, but if you need to have any questions, please use the chat feature, which is located on the lower right side of your screen. We would also like each of the participants to answer this short evaluation questionnaire, which I'm going to bring up right now.
Okay, there's one question. I'll answer that. Okay. You talk.
Okay, and let's see. Here's a question. Actually, a couple questions are coming in now. Let me see.
I have one. So the first one seems to be, has behavioral activation been done with elders in nursing homes? Is there any research? Yes and yes. Yes, it has been done with elders in nursing homes, and yes, there is research on this population. I would have to search it out for you. If you wish to email me the very last slide, I don't think we got to it, but it's in your set, contains my email and Dr. Bullock's email. If you would email me, I'll be glad to share more information about that, but I know it's been done very successfully. There's a group of individuals called psychologists in long-term care, and that's the group that has been promoting the use of behavioral activation in nursing homes, and then they've developed some protocols, and there are some publications on that. So also want to call your attention, just while I have the microphone for a moment, to our reference list at the end. I hadn't mentioned that before, and I should have as we were going along. Virtually all the citations that are on the slide are found in a 3-page reference list that's at the very end after the slide with our emails. Another question from Patricia Kenny: have you found ways to accommodate visually impaired blind patients? That would take a little more creativity. But a lot of this can be done verbally. Certainly, it's not as accurate, perhaps, as the written logs that we've been talking about and the written tracking. But one can set up verbal situations where you can talk to the person about things that they might enjoy, and you can encourage them within the limits of their disability, you know, to implement those particular things. And that's really what behavioral activation is all about. So you would lose the log and the tracking feature, but it certainly can be incorporated on a verbal level.
Make one comment too. Yeah, with visually, just the visually impaired, I think you can
create the monitoring and the log in a big format, so you have it's larger. So that is a really common complaint, that these logs are too small. So I have a few different versions where they're larger in scale, so you can kind of modify those.
Thank you. Yes, so email Dr. Bullock and she will email them back. Is that right?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. All right, and there's a question about what about behavioral activation and depression among caregivers? Is there research on that? Yes, there is. I've conducted a number of studies and many colleagues have, where behavioral activation is incorporated into a package, a program that contains other components. So behavioral activation is often one component of the programs that we use with caregivers. For example, the REACH program that some of you may be familiar with, that program incorporated behavioral activation to some degree. A program that I developed and have used in several studies is called the Coping with Caregiving program. That's a 12-session program. We spend about 4 to 5 on behavioral activation. Those are all where it's been tailored for use among caregivers, particularly dementia family caregivers. Another question, does this change when patients are very old, such as over 100? Well, that's a very good question, because there's absolutely not a shred of, there are no publications about behavioral activation with people over 100. There are publications about behavioral activation with people in their 80s and 90s, so I would be encouraged if you have clients that are 100. I don't see age in itself as being being a deal breaker here. I think it depends upon what the person is able to do, what they're willing to experiment with and increase, and it probably depends on their health as well. I think Dr. Bullock wants to add to this.
Yeah, and I think sometimes too the environment is increasing the stimulation. When people don't have an ability to control their environment, then sometimes family members have to step in, or a nursing home, to create that kind of stimulation that the person doesn't have the ability to go after. So that's important. So you can increase pleasant activities by adding stimulation.
A question, how often do you recommend the CM to visit the client to be effective, once a week or once a month? Well, our experience, we've tried different formats, in terms of frequency, and it seems that you really get more bang for the buck when you do weekly, at least for a month. So you do 4 consecutive, if at all possible, because this keeps the information fresh in the client's mind, helps to keep them motivated. They know they're coming back next week. They need to show you something or be able to talk to you about it. So that would be my recommendation. Would you agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay. Another question, how do you get the client to buy into the log, especially men? Well, I haven't found any particular problem with men, to tell you the truth. We explain it as a way of our getting to know them. That part of what this log is all about is for us to get to know them better, as well as making them more aware, of course, of how they spend their time and where their free hours are, where their gaps are. Maybe they do very little. Many depressed people do much less than the 2 cases that we talked about today. It might be just, getting up, eating, watching TV, and going back to bed again. So it's very helpful for them to see how little they do, because that helps with the motivation. And it's helpful for us to see how little they do, because then we know that we're going to need to start small and go slowly.
Yeah, this may address that question, and I think that the next one about people of trouble, resistance to the discipline of filling out the form. Sometimes people are coercive sensitive, And we had a great example. I had a resident a few weeks ago with an elderly gentleman who didn't want to fill out this form. And so we kind of went with the resistance and said, yeah, you know, that makes sense. It's too much work. And just went over these ideas about increasing pleasant activities. And what was funny was a few weeks later he came back and he was keeping a record, but he had come up with that. So he had to self-generate the idea of the monitoring, and it's almost as if he had to think about it as his own invention, but when it came internally, he was willing to accept it. But sometimes you just have to kind of roll with the resistance and give the preserve the person's autonomy as much as possible.
Yeah, I think that's very well said. I think if you do that, and you will succeed with men as well as women. There's another question about sharing the forms. Yes, someone, I guess a couple of, more than one person sent a private message saying, Could we share with the webinar participants the various forms that we're talking about? And I believe that we can. I don't know the process, but I believe that our coordinator here at the Geriatric Education Center, Marian Zhang, I believe that she can send them out to all of you who are on. Maybe we'll put them up on the website too. I'm not sure because. Okay, Marian just said she can send them out as attachments. Okay, so we will make forms available. Another question, how to work with resistance to the discipline of filling out forms. Yeah, well, again, you do encounter that. Some people, well, with some older individuals, I have, for example, right now, a patient with advanced Parkinson's disease, and she cannot write on a form. She simply cannot. She has too much tardive dyskinesia and she's just unable to focus. However, she is able to use a computer. That's how she communicates with her family and with her doctors and many different people over the computer. So what she was able to do, we were able to develop a simple log that she could use on her computer. So that's one example, though I know that's not quite what you're talking about, but that's an example of an adaptation. You certainly can use a computer. People can use their own little scratch pads if they want to. It's harder for you because you may not be able to read it as well. But the discipline, something that I've done in between if I think that the person is having trouble with this is I've called them. I set up reminder calls, brief calls. They're not therapy sessions. You know, they're 5 minutes or less. And the purpose of the call is to ask them, how are you doing with your homework? You know, have you been able to complete the form? What are some of the problems that you've run into? Can we make it simpler for you? So I call them check-in calls. And I set those up with clients that have difficulty with this. And I would say the last suggestion that I can make is if they absolutely refuse to fill out forms, I'll tell them, call my voicemail number and leave me a message and tell me, you know, I'll set up certain time of day that I know I want them to call. You know, we'll work that out. What time are they going to call? And then I want them to tell me what have they been doing that day. So, again, it's harder for me as the clinician because it means I have to write it down. You know, I have to be sure I check the voicemail. I have to write it down. It takes extra time. But so I don't say that first. You know, I don't offer that first. But as a last resort, I've done that too. And I found that if you work with people and you show you're trying to be flexible, oftentimes that'll kind of melt the resistance too over time. Anything else?
Yeah.
No. Okay. All right. Let's see. Trying to get through the list. Oh, Leilani Feliciano is sharing her experience here. She says, we've used a cue and review type format with micro cassette recorders. Oh, she's talking specifically about visually impaired persons. Used a cue and review type format with micro cassette recorders and have the visually impaired person record their activities on the audio cassette. That's a great idea. Very good. And again, some settings may be more amenable for that to happen, may have that equipment available. So another question is, are there standardized scales to measure activity engagement in adult day health environment? No, not that I know of. That I do not know. If anyone else on the call knows, you know, please type in an answer, but I do not have a response to that. Kim?
Not that I know of. Yeah, somebody out there should make one.
Somebody should make one, okay. When a person has physical limits, have you found doing less than four is still helpful? Well, sure. You start where you can, right? If you've got someone very depressed and physically limited, maybe in a wheelchair, maybe they've had a stroke, so post-stroke depression, they are probably only going to be able to do, or at least at the beginning, one or two things. So, sure, I think that you work with what you have and what the client is able to do. You can certainly aim, though, to get it up, to increase it, maybe by being, by using smaller types of activities or more easier, things that are easy for the person to do. So you might have to spend more time figuring that out with them.
Yeah, you have to use activities that don't require physical efforts, you know, smelling flowers, looking at something beautiful, reading something engaging, watching a show. I mean, something that doesn't require the physical body. But there's lots of other pleasant activities that don't require the body.
Very true. Reading. I don't know if you mentioned reading. But yeah, reading, listening to music. Yeah, very true. Okay, I think I see a few more coming on. There's a question about, let's see, I hope everyone who was interested in the people over 100 are able to read Andrea Feit, F-E-I-T, Andrea Feit's response. Our study participants are centenarians. It would be great to get some data on VA effectiveness. Absolutely. If you want us to consult with you on your research, be delighted. Be delighted. Question on folks with dementia. Okay, a couple of questions on dementia. What about folks with dementia who cannot remember?
Well, my thought is then the onus of responsibility probably falls on the caregivers to stimulate and come up with pleasant activities. It's going to be hard for the person. So, but it's still very important. I have a grandmother with dementia in a nursing home, and boy, can you sure see the difference when her pleasant activities go down. They last month, they had to quarantine everyone due to a virus outbreak, and her mood just plummeted. So these concepts still apply to those with dementia, but again, the onus of responsibility for providing those has to go on to the caregivers.
Yeah, I would very much agree with that. So sometimes the caregiver, sometimes the dyad becomes your patient. You know, it's really the patient plus the caregiver. And there's a question, too, about do you work with families along with the patient in applying VA often, yes, often, especially the more impaired. So the more impaired they are, either physically or cognitively or both, or if they're very, very, very depressed, like a BDI in the 40s or 50s, you know, then yes, you do involve other family members with the patient's permission, of course, but hopefully they'll give you that permission because they are often going to need that extra encouragement and the assistance to carry these things out. So yes, we do. Question on, are we conducting any research along these lines in the Monterey Bay area? Not at the present time, but again, we would be very happy to partner with anyone interested in setting up a research project, or if you have one already set up and you want some consultation, this is a topic near and dear to my heart, and I would be happy to donate some of my time to it. Another question on have we used motivational interviewing Oh, that's a good idea when working with resistant patients. Not with older adults, I haven't. Motivational interviewing, though, has been recommended and has been used with adults, you know, not necessarily older adults, but just regular adults. And there are some studies about the fact that motivational interviewing enhances response to behavioral activation. But to my knowledge, not with older adults. Kim, anything to add on that?
Yes, I think in whatever you're trying to change, concepts of motivational interviewing, definitely, if you have those skills, should be implemented. I'm using motivational interviewing all day long, and I think it enhances whatever intervention you're implementing. So definitely recommend it.
So that's another research project someone should do, right? To see whether or not behavioral activation with older adults, especially the old, you know, does enhance their ability to participate in the process. And then I think this is our final question. Have there been any differences in outcomes related to different causal factors of depression? Well, that's a very thought-provoking question. I would have to say that, in general, the research that I'm familiar with on behavioral activation and with older adults and with ethnically diverse clients does not really focus so much on the causal factors. You know, behavioral activation is a very pragmatic approach. It's like helping the person to do more things that will bring enjoyment into their lives, maybe mastery, too, if that's important to them, or sense of accomplishment, but it seems to work in people who are very, what in the old days used to be called endogenously depressed, so where there seems to be a real heavy biological load on the depression, it works with them too, and that's about as close as I can come to answering that one.
Well, I know with some neuropsychiatric illnesses like post-stroke conditions, sometimes tricyclic antidepressants or stimulants are really necessary to and are a bit more resistant. So I think there are cases and certain factors and health issues that will determine the outcomes. Mm-hmm.
And I think the last question, at least the last one that I see on my screen, are you aware of any of these techniques used in combination with mindfulness meditation practices? The answer would be no. In general, I don't see it as incompatible because one could certainly become more mindful of one's activities, and by becoming more mindful of how you spend your time, that might be a very nice segue for some clients, at least, into increasing the positive activities that they spend their time, how they spend their time. So I don't see it as incompatible, same with the dialectical behavior therapy. But to my knowledge, there are no published studies. I think Dr. Bullock wanted to add to that.
Yeah, I don't know of any published, but just anecdotally, I see that mindfulness actually turns up the volume of pleasure for most people, and a lot of my clients, especially a few, the older ones, have taken up mindfulness and meditation, and it's really been a pleasant activity that's helped with depression immensely.
So that's very interesting. So mindfulness itself could become a pleasant activity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, very nice twist. I hadn't thought about that. And let's see, one more question, and then it's 1:15, which is 15 minutes over our allotted time. And I know that Dr. Bullock and I both have other appointments at 1:30. So I think this is going to be our final question. Before I answer it or try to answer it, I'd like to suggest that everyone please fill out our survey that's showing on your screen. We really, really, really need that information to report back to our funding source, which is HRSA, the Bureau of Health Professions. If you like these webinars, you want us to keep them coming, then we do need your information on the survey. Okay, last question. Can anyone implement behavioral activation? Are there specific disciplines that are considered more appropriate? Well, very apropos of that, Marion, our coordinator here at the SGEC, handed me on my way in this morning a report in the British Journal of Psychiatry, published in 2011 by Eckers, E-K-E-R-S, et al., several other authors, where they show that it is, in fact, cost-effective to have non-specialists provide behavioral activation, and they show, you know, I can't understand it all because it's in British pounds, but they do show a savings, an incremental cost savings ratio for those of you that are interested in that. So if anyone wants that citation, we can send that out too. But my own experience is that I have worked with people with some college, not necessarily, in other words, not necessarily healthcare professionals that I've trained in my work with caregivers. I've trained many non-professionals who are often from the communities that we're trying to work with. So indigenous community workers is how they were referred to in the past. Now I just say, you know, non-professional healthcare workers. And yes, they can be trained in how to do behavioral activation. The training takes longer, you know. What, and in fact, what we've provided you today is the tip of the iceberg, because you really need to learn how to do this, and it takes more in-depth practice. We've given you the didactic background information. Hopefully, got stimulated your thinking. You know, maybe gotten you interested in getting more training. The SGEC will be offering more training, skill-based training in behavioral activation in the months ahead. We don't have our program finalized yet, but it will be something that we will be offering probably by the summer. And so those of you that want more of that, we hope to have it available. So, but the short answer is there are no specific disciplines that are considered more or less appropriate to implement behavioral activation. Okay, and I think with that, we will close. We thank you very much for being such an active group and participating with us and sharing your thoughts and comments. It's been a pleasure to work with you all and have this opportunity today. So good luck in your practices.
This is Chris Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on behavioral activation and effective intervention for late life depression. I'd like to thank the presenters, Drs. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson and Kim Bullock. Thank you. Thank you so much for your participation. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that the completion of the survey allows us to continue to get funding. Our next webinar in the series will be on Thursday, May 10th at the same time. It will be on fall risk and prevention in older adults and presented by Dr. Josette Rivera and Ms. Ellen Corman. Thank you.